Hi, Demuxed from Australia. My name's Jeremy Brown. I work at a company called Optus Sport in video delivery. I'm also the organizer with Amy on Sydney Video Technology in Australia. So today I've come to talk about Trick View. What is Trick View? It's got lots of names. You're probably familiar with one of them or a couple of them: thumbnail, scrubbing, seeking, preview pane, thumbnail track, playlist. It all kind of means one thing, and that's this. The feature where you scrub through a timeline and you get a preview image of the video to help guide you to where in the video you want to land. We all are familiar with it. Moving on. Today's talk, I'm going to cover four approaches that we built and why we kept them all. So we kept them all because our approach evolved. You can see here we started with the images and we evolved into APIs, playlists, and keyframes. But today I'm going to start at the end and then go back to the beginning. So keyframe playlist is part of a spec for video delivery. If you read the Pantos HDR spec, you can find publish a keyframe playlist rendition. If you read Dash, it reads a bit differently, but it's pretty obvious what it is. In the way, same way you have a video rendition, you also have an audio rendition, and you can have a keyframe rendition. And the beauty of this standard is that it's a native integration. You don't have to develop anything once you're publishing that rendition. The Apple TV just picks it up and works with it. And for a lot of encoders, it's just a tick a box feature. You just turn it on, it publishes that rendition, and away you go. That's not what my experience was. That's what I wanted to do, but we found that immediately that we had players that wouldn't support this feature. We were missing the tick box. We couldn't just turn on this rendition as part of our encoding stack immediately anyway. So we had to evolve to that, and that's where we got through. And then what do we do with the existing encoded library? Are we really proposing re-transcoding it all, re-encoding it all? How do we get to a state where we have this feature without the overhead? So we started with keyframe images, and it really, when we first got first were asked to build this feature, it seemed a no-brainer. You would create images. That the players would handle the UX and the position and all the other detail. But you would just create these keyframes. And so the solution was the obvious. Pull a keyframe every few seconds, give it a name that means something against the time code in the video, and we're done, right? So creating images every few seconds using FFmpeg, I think if you look in the wiki, it's pretty obvious. It's pretty straightforward. It was easy. Naming it every 5 seconds, 10 seconds, 15 seconds, having a 5-second interval made a lot of sense. We thought we were done. Feature shipped. But that's not exactly what happened, because immediately we found all these disadvantages to the solution. You know, the janking image loading experience as an image would be fetched as the user scrubbed along, and you couldn't scrub download all the images. That would be ridiculous before the user scrubbed. So we were building this player development, so how to do positioning and how to handle things that were native to a lot of players already. They were having to develop that in duplicate and then redevelop it onto a connected TV, redevelop it onto another brand of television. So it became a bit cumbersome in that regard. And each player required a different size image because of the size of a television versus the size of a phone. Every 5 seconds was a magic number we made up. Probably didn't make sense in the long run. It created lots of images, like lots of images. So the product manager asked pretty quickly, you know, can we fix the jank as it's having to download images as you scroll along? It's not fluid. And we wondered, well, if we reduce the number of images, we could do that. And so we thought about it for a little while and we came up with the Sprite Sheet. Those who aren't familiar with Sprite Sheets, it's you take a number of images that you want. You stitch it into one bigger image. This was a technique used in gaming to keep under the memory limits that they had. And so you choose an X, Y position and you can actually just generate the image based on the bigger image. CSS obviously made a lot of sense. It could interchangeably, we could do sprite sheets quite easily. So we went out and we decided to build an API for sprites. And basically you take the images, the keyframes that we'd already developed and stitch them into sprites. It was easy. But we immediately found some real problems. Like, is a 3-hour long video sprite even reasonable? Like, does this make sense? And so we realized also, it's so obvious when you talk about it now, but a timeline width never actually changes. If you upload a video that's 30 seconds long, or 3 hours long, or 20 minutes long, the width of the screen never changes. So the width of the player control never changes, but a pixel width in there could mean represent a different length of time. It could represent a second, it could represent a fraction of a second, or it could represent 20 minutes. So you had to think about that. And we also realized pretty quickly that there's limits to how big a JPEG can be. There's 65,000 pixels wide. So with a 3-hour video at 5-second intervals, we were creating too many images. The sprite was too big. The file size was too big. The intervals were probably too small. They became too fiddly on the player to control. So we needed to create variables around that stuff. So the solution was obvious, to create many smaller sprites rather than one giant sprite, because that would get too big as a file. We needed to calculate that interval. So a short video needs a very short interval, but a longer video, like a 3-hour video, might need a good 15, 20 seconds interval. We wanted to be able to resize the images because of all the players were different. Any CDN will do this for you nowadays. It's pretty standard if you ask for a width of an image. But we needed to create all those smaller images in multiple sizes, standardize that somewhat so that we weren't creating too many variants, but then stitch it together into the sprite. And then really just a matter of grouping and stitching based on the interval, based on the width, into time groups that we could allow. So as you scrub along, the first 500 seconds, you've only had to get one image. You've removed the jank somewhat. So we've saved the feature. We can keep it. The team were happy. We thought we'd solved everything. We thought we'd kick a goal, or at least saved a goal. A developer came up to me one day who was working with a popular player and asked, well, why don't we just have VTT thumbnails? It's supported directly. And I said, because VTT is a captions format. It's not image thumbnails. So serves me right. Everyone should read the manual. You should look into the spec. Pro tip, understand what you're saying before you open your mouth, I guess. VTT playlist was then a feature. And it made a lot of sense because when I looked into the VTT and what we'd already done with Sprite API, it was very similar. It was really just became a feature of Sprite API to publish into the VTT spec. We weren't having to redevelop anything significantly. We just had to change the output. So it became a feature of the Sprite API. It worked with many of the name brand OVP players that we didn't have to develop anything into the player. So it was instantly it became an instant feature on a lot of players. Because of the timing, we were able to add SSAI support, so understand where the ads were stitched and what break durations they were, what those intervals would be, and then adding that in capability into the scrub so that we had a better solution. So we had four solutions, and why did we keep them all? The keyframe images were the core of all of these solutions. Basically, creating those images at those intervals was how we were able to build this feature out into other variants. The Sprite API was the core to the VTT support. But what we did find very quickly was devs found other uses for Sprite API. Being able to understand very quickly where in the position of a video you could pull out a keyframe to create a user experience, perhaps you'd been playing a video and you'd paused, gone away, come back, those sort of experiences, that was really important. So the VTT playlist was used on many devices, and we still use it in many devices, even though we have a keyframe playlist. There were just certain players that just wouldn't support it. And it got us thinking at the end of this, what else could keyframes do? We have these great images. What can we do with them? And it seemed pretty obvious from Sprite API we could create a somewhat janky, probably not perfect experience, but for a connected TV, an engaging experience around where a user has selected a piece of content, what that content is. And so they can kind of get a sense of if they've seen it before or whether this was the sort of content that they were interested in. You know, indexing images is a lot easier and a lot cheaper than indexing video. A lot less hassle moving large files around and things like that. So we started indexing the keyframes for metadata and context, and we start using that for other features, recommendation engines, advertising, things like that. So that was pretty key to having those images to build that solution out. The last one is Sprite Sheets for QC. So we had all these images, we could stitch them into one big video, one big image, and it gave our content editors and publishing teams the ability to quite quickly see what the video will look like start to finish within about a second of clicking an image. So that was a pretty nice feature. That's my talk. I've gone a little bit over my 10 minutes, but hopefully they'll let me play it out. Thank you very much, and stay safe, everyone.